We now begin to consider species formation that is largely due to non-genic incompatibilities, sometimes known as chromosomal speciation. As with genic incompatibilities, the contributions of the mother and father begin to differ, and to resolve this, the father must find a compatible mate, and the mother must find a compatible mate. What's that? Would the mutation that made them differ so that one is pink and one is green have affected their normal appearances or functions? No. Like most of the genic mutations that we discussed in earlier videos, the non-genic mutations would have been specific to the reproductive system, so that otherwise these individuals would appear absolutely normal. I think you'll see this more clearly when we've fleshed out a bit of the underlying biology and biochemistry. Again, trying as best we can to keep everything in everyday language. We'll begin by considering genes and DNA, then go on to chromosomes, and finally get to the heart of the problem by considering cell division. So we begin with a linear DNA text containing genetic information which is passed through the generations. And parts of that text we designate as being genic, as being genes. And the most important feature of genes is that they specify how the 20 building blocks which make proteins are ordered in those proteins. So in a particular protein, the first building block might be blue, the second building block might be pink, the third building block might be green, and so on, to generate a protein that may be many hundreds of building blocks in length. And this unique order determines how the linear protein will fold and what its specific functions will be. It would not be inappropriate to describe proteins as work-crazy slaves ever at the ready to do the cell's bidding. Now, you're probably sitting on your cushion and you clapped your hands and your slave turned on your computer so that you could look at this video. You clapped again and he brought you a platter of peaches and grapes, and you clapped again and the rich aroma of coffee soon filled the room, because he is a multitasking slave. But protein slaves are not so flexible. Each is highly specialized. If they work for you, one would be turning on your computer, another would be bringing you a platter of peaches, and another would be making you some coffee. And this specialized function is determined by the unique sequence of the building blocks, and that unique sequence is determined by the genes. Following the instructions of the genes, the cell constructs these proteins, each one entirely specific. Thus, another protein might begin with a green building block. Amongst the choice of 20 possibilities, the next building block would be red. Again, from the same choice of 20 possibilities, the third building block is yellow. And we have another highly specific protein, which will curl up in a specific way. So we have a set of genes, and they determine the proteins that will be made. We can think of them as protein slave 1, slave 2, and slave 3. And slave 1 will do the cellular equivalent of turning on your computer. Slave 2 will do the cellular equivalent of bringing a platter of peaches and grapes. And slave 3 will do the cellular equivalent of making you some coffee. Now, as I said, these slaves are work crazy. So we shouldn't be surprised that after an hour or two of working their fingers to the bone, they literally keel over and die. But the cell is not troubled by this. It uses the information contained in its genes to make more of the slaves. So proteins are constantly turning over. When the first version of slave 1 dies, the cell immediately makes another version to replace it. So the concentration of proteins within the cell remains constant. The cell is never without its slaves unless there is a variation or mutation. So if suddenly the supply of peaches falls, one knows that something has gone wrong with the continued production of slave 2, which means there has been a variation or mutation at the level of the gene that encodes slave 2. Whenever there is a failure in peach production, we can trace it back to a mutation somewhere in this particular region, the region of the gene. Occasionally, we'll find a mutation outside the gene, but generally the mutation is in the genic region. And these are genic mutations or genic variations. Now you'll recall that variation is a constant, so all parts of the DNA are changing, both genic and non-genic. And the changes or mutations which we obtain in regions outside genes we can refer to as non-genic mutations. So again, while most non-genic mutations are outside genes, occasionally one finds a mutation in a gene that seems better classified as non-genic. So these are broad categories. There's a group of mutations which localize in regions which encode proteins, and there are other mutations which locate in regions which do not encode proteins. Now, in earlier videos, we began to talk about variations in lineages. So over time, there were variations in DNA, and there were corresponding changes in the form and function of organisms. We can now point to an intermediary, changes in proteins. So a mutation in DNA causes a mutation in a protein, and that mutation brings about a change in form or function of an organism. And now we're ready to move on to chromosomes. We can depict the total DNA you inherit from one of your parents as a line, and the total DNA you inherit from the other parent also as a line. So if you're female, this might be the total DNA you get from your father, we'll call it paternal DNA, and this might be the DNA you get from your mother, maternal DNA. And we'll repeat this for a male child. And again, there are paternal and maternal contributions. Except that in this case, the paternal is a little bit less than the maternal. And the genes distributed along this DNA are collinear, meaning that a gene for a particular character is in the same position on both copies in both sexes. This might be a gene for eye color. More likely, there are several genes for eye color, and each of these will be collinear to the others, whether you be male or female. So if we come across individuals with mutations in eye color, we can usually trace the mutations back to one of these regions on the DNA. So this is the total information, the total DNA information you inherit from your parents, And this is found in every cell of your body. So since this contains all the information for making, say, a liver or a brain or a kidney, then one comes across the idea of differential expression. That is, in a kidney cell, the kidney part of the DNA will be expressed and the brain parts will be turned off. In a brain cell, the brain genes will be turned on and the kidney genes will be turned off. So this is the total information you inherit from your parents. This is the book which will be read by the cells and which will determine your final form and function. And like most books, it is divided into chapters, 23 chapters. And these chapters are called chromosomes. And like chapters in books, some chapters are longer than others. So the first chapter, the first chromosome, is chromosome 1. The second chapter is a little bit shorter. The third chromosome, shorter still. And so on. For a total of 23 chromosomes. So the chromosomes, which of course are not organized quite so simply as this within cells, are given numbers according to their length, a higher number usually meaning the chromosome is getting smaller, until finally we arrive at chromosome 23, which, as you can see, is longer than chromosome 22 and 21. This is the sex chromosome. And here the difference between the lengths of the paternal chromosome which was passed on to the male and the paternal chromosome which was passed on to the female becomes apparent. Chromosome 23 in the male is considerably smaller than chromosome 23 in the female. So chromosomes 23 are the sex chromosomes, known as X in females and X and Y in males. And genes affecting a particular character locate to particular chromosomes. And now we move on from chromosomes to consider cell division. Most cells in the body have a lifespan of days or weeks or months, and when they die or are discarded, they are replaced by cell division. The cell is the fundamental organizational unit within which biological processes occur. And it is limited by the cell membrane and contains within itself various other membranes, the most important of which is the nuclear membrane, within which the chromosomes and their DNA are found. And when division occurs, it is usually important that all cell components are divided equally. And this is particularly important in the case of the chromosomes, and here we will be mainly concerned with the way the chromosomes are divided. For this purpose, it's easiest to just forget about the other cell components and forget about the nuclear membrane and just think of a cell as a bag of chromosomes. And instead of having 23 pairs of chromosomes, we'll just have two chromosomes, one big one and one small one. So there'll be one large chromosome from the father and one small chromosome from the father, and one large chromosome from the mother and one small chromosome from the mother. And of course, if we just divided the cell as it stands, we'd lose half the DNA. Half the DNA would have to go to one cell and half the DNA would go to the other cell. So first of all, the DNA must be replicated. And here the work-crazy protein slaves come into play. They carefully and faithfully make one copy of each chromosome. And the cell also has to grow bigger because it's going to divide. And then the chromosomes are going to align in the center of the cell. Of course, they don't do this by themselves. It's the cells, protein slaves, who make it all happen. Working like crazy, the protein slaves then pull one member of each chromosome pair to opposite sides of the cell. So members of each duplicate are separated from each other. And then the cell goes into dumbbell mode. And the two cells pinch off from each other without losing the continuity of the cell membrane. So this is how the division of the somatic cells come about, how division of the cells of the soma come about. But we're considering this merely to allow comparison with the fundamental type of division which goes on in the germline. Now, if you clap your hands, you can get your slave to move you on to the next video.